And if they have to pass it on to somebody and you are already their contact, they're going to do it for you. I mean, I...
Hi, everyone. Thanks for tuning into D-Education. So this is a platform where I bring designers from different aspects to talk about their design education and how their design education has shaped them into better designers. And so in this episode, we have a very special guest here. Hi, Maitri. Welcome to D-Education.
Hey, thank you for having me.
So Maitri, how's your day?
Oh, it was good. Today was actually pretty busy since it's Monday. But yeah, it's always good to just wrap up and talk to fellow designers, I guess.
That's wonderful, Maitri. So if you would give a brief about yourself to our viewers out there.
Yeah, sure. So hello, everybody. My name is Maitri. I'm a freelance designer. I'm based in Bangalore, India. And I'm working with a lot of clients from California to Seoul, Korea. And it is really amazing to be an independent in today's century. So
that's wonderful, Maitri. So what was your journey into art, illustration and design? And if you could take us through your different aspects of your journey with us.
Yeah, sure. So the thing was, like, I'm pretty grateful that my family already have a lot of artists, a lot of creative people. So we had a lot of like architects and designers and artists in general. So it wasn't a very shocking thing when I showed up, you know, at my house saying, you know, I want to be an artist or an animator or something like that. But I think I took it for granted before, because now becoming a designer professionally, I meet a lot of, you know, colleagues and fellow designers. I then understand how rare it is when families support. So I'm really grateful that it was already in my family. And so it actually was quite easy for me to transition into an artist and get, you know, the proper education that I wanted or the proper gadgets that I need. So yeah, they played a big role in it. Being like starting off as an artist, I actually wanted to be an animator. I mean, I was really drawn into like films. I used to watch a lot of Ghibli movies, just anime in general, Disney, Pixar. So I always thought that I would kind of go into character design or, you know, just animation. Like that part, which is so cool. I mean, you see it on movies and everything, and you kind of are still drawn to it. So that was like my initial idea of what I want to become when I grow up. And even when I was in college, I was getting my degree. My specialty was in illustration, but my thesis that I did for my last year was on character design, because I still kind of had the hope that I would go into animation or something like that. But I slowly, when I started to understand about the industry, I kind of fell in love with just the process of creating characters, or, you know, just the process of understanding art or illustration or the background, the scenes and everything. So I kind of fell in love with illustration, like in general, and not just character design. I loved just seeing and drawing like backgrounds and details and like concepts, ideas. And so I really started liking typography and other aspects of design. So the idea of me being an animator kind of fell apart. And I'm thankful, because being a designer is so much, I just love it. And yeah, I think I would still say that I'm still exploring being a designer and an illustrator. I think being a creative person is all about exploration and understanding the process. So yeah, it is still an ongoing process. It's still an ongoing experience. So
thank you, Maitri, for taking us through your wonderful journey. So let's discuss about the freelancing aspect, being an artist, which is something very rarely found in our Indian ecosystem. So what was your experience getting into freelancing as an independent artist?
So after getting my degree, I always wanted to be a freelancer, because I was already started to getting projects when I was in college, like in second year or something. I was getting small projects like for typography, like making posters, I think we all do. And I understood that I really loved like getting clients pitching the work and, you know, doing the process from start to finish. And I just said to my family, like, I'm not going to do a job. I just really want to go just all in with my freelance thing after my college is done. But as my family already have a lot of artists, they said that you should actually get an experience before you go freelance, because that is, it's going to teach you a lot of things. And I was kind of skeptical. I mean, you know, being a kid just out of college, I was like, oh, come on, what does my family know, you know? But actually, it turned out to be like they were right. They are always right, actually. But yeah, I'm so glad that I did, because I lasted for 2 years in my job. I always thought it would just be like 1 year and, you know, finish it and I'll just go for my freelance gig. But I really loved doing a job, and I looked for a smaller agency and not a like an IT company, because the smaller the company is, the more things you get to do and the more things you learn very quickly. The bigger the company is, your role is pretty small and specialized. But when you like get into an agency or a studio, which is like a smaller, like with 10, 15 people, 20 people, you sometimes have to manage projects. You have to go with the founder to pitch the project, or you have to even go for like brainstorming sessions, even if you're a junior designer. And it, all of this is so cool sometimes. Like I've been to, thanks to the founders who I've worked with, they took me to sets and exhibitions and expos. And, you know, I got to see them actually pitching projects to clients, to potential clients. And if you think that if I were in like a big company, like an IT company or something, I mean, I don't think I could have experienced all of this being in a big firm. So I was really glad to have landed such a great job for like 2 years, and I really loved it. I did everything there and I learned so much. So after that, I actually thought of going freelance, because I kind of started building up clients. Even when I was doing the job, I was doing the freelance gig. I built up clients pretty much good. I was like putting up content on Instagram and Dribbble and Behance and everything. So clients started to come up for inquiries and everything. And I thought, yes, now it's the time to, you know, hit the road alone and be an independent designer. So I did. It was really hard, I'm not going to lie. I saved up a lot of money before like switching the job, switching the fields, but it took me some time to actually get on my feet like really well. It takes a lot of hard work. It's not that easy. I understand why people say freelancing is really hard, because you have to be your own boss, your own employee, you have to be your own accountant, your manager, your everything. So it can be sometimes overwhelming, but the kind of freedom that you get is, it's really awesome. And yeah, it's nowadays you can see India having more and more freelancers in illustration, UI, UX, and design in general. And it's great to see the market is blooming with amazing independent designers. So yeah, it's really awesome.
That's wonderful, Maitri. So if you have to suggest 5 things to a young artist who want to transform or go into freelancing, what will your 5 advices to him or her?
5 tips. I think first would be financial tip. It would be just to save up at least 6 months of salary. The amount of money that you need for another 6 months to provide yourself, you know, to survive, like your rent and food and essentialities, like gadgets and things that you have to buy. 6 months of money should be set aside before you go freelance, because trust me, you're going to need that money. And once you start going freelance, you understand that you need this and that gadget and everything, and the expenses are pretty quick. Without like first few months can be like really low pay. I mean, expect that and start acting that way, because you don't have to be stressed out about the financial situation, because already you are stressed out about getting clients. So first would be to save up a lot of money and then switch your jobs. Second would be to get help. I think we have such a great community online. I mean, Instagram, Behance, Adobe, like you name it, we have like support groups. Nowadays, I think Clubhouse is a really good platform, you know? So just reach out. There are a lot of people outside like who already have jobs, who already have projects that they can't do. And if they have to pass it on to somebody and you are already their contact, they're going to do it for you. I mean, I have a lot of designers, like fellow freelance people, independent designers, illustrators who like me, we are like bombarded with a lot of projects, and sometimes they don't fit in our schedules, or they don't have enough budgets, or something or the other, and we have to say no, but they usually ask for recommendations. So whoever we have in our mind, like whoever pops up, we usually just give it to them, because why not? So second, have connections. I think we really have an amazing community on social media right now. Third would be to network, and not just on social media, but like in general, in exhibitions and expos, and you know, through agencies. I mean, I know because of COVID, it is kind of hard nowadays to actually physically go somewhere, but LinkedIn is also a great place. I mean, again, it's a social media, but it's more of a professional place, like write articles, not just designs. I mean, I've seen people reading articles and hiring people because of it. Whenever I post an illustration, always remember to tag people, because whenever I post my illustration, I always have like a freelance or freelance designer or editorial illustration or something specific that people usually search for when they hire. So be very mindful on how you network, and you know, be open about it, and don't be afraid to use professional networks as well as you do like Instagram or Behance or Dribbble or something like that. They are also like great, just great platforms to work with. The fourth one would be to read a lot of books. I know it's like a cliche, but books in general, I would say it can be not just be about design, because last year for me, it was like read design, you know, read just design books, like, you know, Win with That Pigeon Manifesto and all that. And I've read all of it and they're so amazing. But to get inspiration, you kind of also have to read something outside of design, because everybody's in design are reading about design books. So you don't have to be in the same mindset. You have to go a little bit outside the box to, you know, get the different kind of illustrations or if different kinds of concept or ideas and stuff. So, you know, I'm recently reading about like plants in general, bonsai plants book, which is really great. They have amazing shapes and colors, and the process is amazing, and it kind of, you know, lifts you up. It puts you in a different shoe, and you kind of start thinking about different things, and you know, it inspires you. And whenever I do illustrations nowadays, and if I want to add plants nowadays, I see the difference that I do, like different illustrations that I do when it comes to plants. And you know, these are the small things that add up when you start reading a lot of different things. I think fifth would be just keep exploring. If you are thinking about, you know, I'll be a logo designer, you don't have to be a logo designer like for your life. You can still explore, you can put illustration into it, you can have a specialty in logo design and maybe, you know, support that with typography or, you know, videography or something like that. Just keep exploring, just be a creative. I mean, we don't have a specific field set for our entire life, so you can, you know, branch out and do something else, because I started out as a logo and branding designer, and now I'm an illustrator. I still do logo and branding. I love it, but keep exploring. It keeps your creativity going. I would say don't settle for one just now. Keep exploring. You like have your options open. That's it. Those are my five tips.
That's wonderful, Maitri. So a creator, how does he increase his value over the period while he's growing? What are the various things that he should look out for so that he can keep on increasing his growth and value as well in the freelance community?
So nowadays, actually, value is linked towards money. And I completely agree. It also should be linked with like experience and the type of quality you are giving to the client. And it's not just the client, but the amount of power you kind of hold onto your work or on social media, because people or clients usually love to see designers who are active and who are actually, you know, just continuously posting or are very aware of what is happening into the design world. And I would say the more popular you become, you know, in a simpler terms, like the more followers you have, the more clients you'll get. It's like a simple definition of it. So if people see value, some clients see value in likes and followers, some clients see value in general your quality of art. But I would just say have both. Like if you have good experience, your quality will grow, but don't be shy to post it online so that, you know, more people would see it. You can reach to more people, more clients, and more potential clients, or just companies in general, because they're always looking out on social media because they have no idea on where to look for you unless and until they just stumble onto you like randomly in the internet. So when it comes to value, it is all about not just the professional workflow that you are doing, but also the things that you're doing for your personal projects, the amount of connections that you have in the design world or in general for the company that you are working in. That all counts into the amount of value that you have and the value that you hold. So the more value you hold, the more you can charge because you have a much better experience in all of this now. And clients usually tend to have a better mindset with people who actually hold a good experience for the longer amount of time than a person who's just started into design. So I would just say have a good experience and get connections and network into the design world. I think that would increase your value in general. Yeah.
Thank you, Maitri, for those wonderful insights. So what do you think in this current pandemic situation, how is the freelance industry going, and any advice that you could suggest to young creatives who are still in college, they could try on their hands on some freelance projects?
But the thing is, like, interestingly enough, nowadays, freelancers are having a growth in their business because of COVID. And I think it is because clients and companies don't have that much income that they usually do in COVID. And that's why they don't want to invest in like bigger agencies and like studios right away. So sometimes they feel like, you know, freelancers can do the same thing, but for less, even if they can give like less of a value in compared to like agencies could give. So freelancers have seen a huge boost in work because a lot of my friends who I talk with daily, like in design, illustration, in general art field, we were kind of scared when the COVID hit and we didn't know of what to do and if the business were going to go, because there were huge companies that were falling off and we were just freelancers. I mean, we didn't know what would happen, but there was such a huge spike into like freelance business because being in COVID, people didn't mind the distance. People didn't mind the remote working of people. And it was the best time for freelancers to actually hit the jackpot. And I've seen people getting like huge deals during COVID. If you are a designer, I mean, I've seen a lot of people like losing their jobs and getting into freelance just because of the negative news of losing a job. But they hit a jackpot with freelancing gigs during COVID. So if you really want to start freelancing, this is really a good time. But I would say, again, you know, the five tips: have money saved a bit, have few good connections so that you can have a good rapport. Just reach out to designers, like freelance designers who are on Instagram, LinkedIn, and just tell them that you're looking for a freelance gig and send them your portfolio and what you can offer as a service. Because nowadays, independent designers, independent studios, like small studios or freelancers are getting huge inquiries. And if you are in their network, if you are in their contact already, they would have your number in the list and they would contact you if they have to pass on the projects. And nowadays, it's a huge thing to do. I've passed on a lot of projects to a lot of people that I know. So have a good communication skills, like just reach out to designers in general and network good. I think it's a good time to be a freelancer right now.
So Maitri, what are the set of good tools or in terms of gadgets that a freelancer could purchase in his initial days?
Right. I think just when you are starting, a good laptop or a good PC would do. I personally am a laptop person because being a freelancer, I don't like to get stuck at one place. You know, with a PC, you have to be at your own table. But I am a laptop person in general. So have a good laptop, a good PC, in general, a good computer that can help you go through with like heavy projects and like videography, like editing and photography and whatever you are doing right now. Have a good system that you can trust. If you want, have a secondary system like a basic desktop or something that could just help you if your laptop goes down. I mean, I think that's the only essential thing that you need when you start. And that was the only essential thing that I had when I started. Slowly, as I started building my work, like as a professional freelancer, and I started doing more content and everything, I started investing into a good camera, which I'm recording with right now. It's the Canon 200D Mark II. It's really good. I think it's the basic camera. I think in US it's called the Canon Rebel or something, but it's a very basic camera. The other thing of investing is in good hard disks. Hard disks are something that you need every time, because being a freelancer, you have to store your clients' projects for the future if they need your help again. I usually go for passport hard disks, which are always good. I think a lot of designers use them too. Even the Samsung ones are good. Then I think the recent one that I invested in, it was a huge expense, a huge investment, but a worthwhile investment. And it was the iPad Pro. I had a Wacom for such a long time, a Wacom tablet, which was like the basic tablet that you can get. In 2012, I got it. 2012 or 2013, when I was in my college, I got it for like college assignments. I was still using it the last year. It is so good. It is really worth it. A Wacom can go a long way. I trust it. I still use it, even though I have my iPad. But I recently invested in an iPad for illustrations and like sketching and everything, which is really good because I travel a lot. So sometimes if I don't have to take my laptop, I just take my iPad with me. So don't worry about investing a lot of money into freelancing or into gadgets just right away. Do it slowly so that you don't just burn off your savings and your income and everything. A good laptop, good mouse and a keyboard can go a long way. And trust your gadgets, whatever you buy, and trust yourself and save up so that you can buy more and more. So, and hoard up a lot of gadgets that you can. So, yeah.
Thank you so much, Maitri, for sharing all these wonderful insights with us. We're looking forward to host you again in our upcoming episodes. Thanks for your wonderful time.
Thank you so much for having me. It was such a great time talking to you. Thank you so much.